The most vulnerable piece of evidence to attack is the key. And that's because of the evidence the state presented. So the key isn't found until there have been repeated searches of Avery's trailer. All of that was highly suspicious. But overriding that is the DNA of Stephen Avery on the key.
Now, when you tested this swab from the key, you used the entire swab, didn't you?
Yes.
A identical vehicle was obtained, and an identical key was obtained to try and reproduce what the state came up with in terms of the amount of the DNA that was recovered. Ms. Zellner went up to Mr. Avery's prison and was able to bring in a key and have Mr. Avery hold a key, and that was timed for 12 minutes. So we can measure how much DNA we got from the same kind of key held for what we'd imagine is the same amount of time by the same person. The state got 0.17 nanograms per microliter. The amount of DNA that we recovered from the exemplar key is a tenth or so of the amount of DNA that the Wisconsin lab obtained from their key.
Mr. Buting, I believe it was, had the imagination, let's call it, to suggest to you that maybe officers were taking a toothbrush and were kind of rubbing Mr. Avery's toothbrush on the key, and that's how the DNA got on the key.
A recurring theme in the case, and something that's so suspicious and such a red flag, is that there are never mixtures on any of these items. So once again, we can't duplicate what the state claimed happened. And we should have been able to duplicate that easily over and over and over again. So how could we have all of these scientific aberrations in one case?